Because God wants to speak with us in our own language. Let it be our heart language between Him and us. If you would stand for the call to worship. Call to worship this morning is Psalms 107, 1, 2, and 6 through 9. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom He has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. They cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them out of their distresses. He led them forth by the right way, that they might go to a city for a dwelling place. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for His goodness, for His wonderful works to the children of men. For He satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. May the Lord add His blessing to His words today. And may you join us in singing the opening hymn.
Father in heaven, we're so thankful that you meet with us when we come together and that you send your spirit to be with us. And so this morning, we ask that our hearts can be open and our minds can be open to the words and the songs and the prayers, that we can all look to you and be drawn closer to you through Jesus. We pray in his name, amen.
Here is something else we get to do new. We're going to pick up the offering again instead of having you put it in the back. So that's an exciting thing that we are taking up again. Today the offering is for the General Conference World Budget. And I'm sure that goes for a lot of projects in the mission field. I read a story this last week about building on to the school at Holbrook Mission School. And I know that some of those things mission-wise are part of the world budget. So as you give locally here to the local church budget, please also remember the church budget. We bow our heads for prayer. Dear Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity to give back to you. We can never outgive you, but we do want the opportunity to share with you in the work of saving souls. And we ask that you would bless what we give. In Jesus' name, amen. The children can get their baskets. I think that they're in the back. And you can get your baskets and pick up the offering.
Happy Sabbath. You guys sound out of practice. You think you have an excuse since you haven't been up here for a while? Let's try it again. Happy Sabbath. Are you really happy? There, that's good. All right, I like it. Let's keep filling it up. All right. Look at all these smiling faces. We have missed seeing these faces up close and personal. I have a story for you, and this is quite the story. How many of you have a dog? All right. Nathan, you just got... Oh, I got to get a microphone here. I'm going to get the green one. You just got a dog, didn't you? Well, tell us a little bit about your dog. What's his name or her name? Or is it a boy or a girl? What is it?
Her name is Kylo. Or Kylo.
Yeah, I can see why. And is she a good dog?
Mm-hmm. She's already trained.
Okay, did you hear that, everyone? She's already trained.
Like, they said she used to be a stray, but she used to be a Texas dog on the street, but...
A Texas dog, huh?
But we're starting to think she may have been... she actually was trained, but then became a stray eventually.
Wow. Well, I'm glad she has a home now.
Mm-hmm. But she is a chomper.
A chomper?
She can...
Eat a lot or chew a lot?
She likes to chew on things a lot. She definitely can... she may have turned one of her hedgehog toys inside out.
Ooh. Well, you have to put your toys away.
Yep.
All right. Well, maybe we can dim the lights here. I want you to see this. I went to Texas this weekend to visit my older daughter, and this is what I walked into when I went to her house. I want you to see this. All right, so look right there on the screens. I guess you have one right here, too. This is what I walked into. So there's eight, and they're not, Nathan, they're not potty trained. There's eight. So now, these are animals that God made, right? And I have three dogs, and I go over there, and she's got eight more. And by the way, I have three dogs because of this daughter. But I want to tell you a little story. I was having a Bible study, and my wife called me, and she used her man voice, and she says, "Come home." I was like, "Yes, she wants to see me. She misses me. She loves me." And then I heard her scream, and she said, "Ah!" Sort of just like that. I made my hair in the back of my neck, and yours too, stand up. And she goes, "There's a mouse in the house." And we have a little house, so there's no room for a mouse. So needless to say, that Bible study ended somewhat early, if not on time, and I went home. So I looked for this huge, scary mouse. I mean, she screamed, so it must have been huge. So I'm looking, and it's a small house, right? It's little. I'm in a little house. And I looked, and I looked. And finally, I could not find that mouse, and I went and took a shower, and then I looked up in the skylight, and I saw, let's see, do I have a picture? I think I have a picture. Look at that big, scary mouse. Now, by the way, to give you a proportion how big that mouse was, this is my finger. It was about that big, the tip of my finger. It was a small baby mouse. So you can imagine what I did in the shower when I saw it. I screamed, "Ah!" No, I didn't scream. I called my wife. I said, "Sweetie, you are afraid of this cute, fuzzy, soft mouse?" And she says, "There's no room in that house, in this house, for that mouse." So it makes me think. I have three dogs, and she allows the dogs. And Nathan, you have a dog, and you guys raise your hands for dogs. They're allowed in the house. But the mouse is not allowed in the house. And it makes me think God wants each of us in his house. I want to read a Bible verse for you. I mean, they're both good looking. They're both fuzzy. They're both soft. But what I love about God is this. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God." Jesus said, "Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there's many mansions." That's going to be big houses. And he says, if it were not so, I would not have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So not always do mom and dads want a mouse in the house. But the beauty of Jesus is he wants all of us in his house. How many of you want to be in his house? I know I do. All right. Now, I also have a special treat for you. Now, let me pray first, and then I'm going to pass it out. But I got, I got action Bibles for you. And I wasn't sure how many would show up. So I promise you this, that if I run out of Bibles, I have 10 more coming on, or 15 more coming on Sunday. I have 25. Then we might cover it. But we'll each get you each a Bible if you want one. So let's pray here. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for sweet puppies and even small mice. So Lord, I want to thank you for loving us unconditionally. And Lord, you want us in your house forever. And Lord, I pray that we choose you today and forever. Thank you for all these young people. Bless them. And Lord, may they be men and women of God for you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so Ken, you want to help me pass them out? All right, I guess we got to pull them out here first. Go. Happy Sabbath. You want one? You got it. You got it. There you go. There you go.
I'm seeing my friend DeAndre today, so.
Oh, are you? Oh, are you? Okay. Well, let's make sure everyone gets one, but we'll make sure DeAndre gets one.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I have one already. Are you planning to give this one to him today? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Oh. Thank you.
Dear Father, we wanted to give you praise today for the joy there is in your house. And I know there's joy in heaven over one sinner that repents. And so I'm sure that you know each one of our names by heart and that you are excited that we are here at your house today worshiping you. We ask a special blessing on those who are not able to be with us today. We ask for your healing for those that are sick. We also ask that you would bring COVID to an end. We've seen some changes and we have been able to do some things, but Lord, there is still much that needs to be healed in our world, and we ask that you intercede. Please comfort those that are grieving today. Draw close to them in a special way. Please be with those that are traveling. Give them traveling mercy and safety. We pray that you would join with all of those that were going to Vacation Bible School today and tomorrow, that your Holy Spirit will be there to impress truths upon their hearts and to bless. And we ask that you be with our pastor today, that your Holy Spirit will speak through him, and that you would open our ears that we might hear what you have to say. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for doing more than we can ask or imagine, according to your will, as it is in Christ Jesus. Amen.
was really nice to see all the young people up front, was it not? Addie, would you like to come up with me and why don't we read the scripture together? How about we pray together? What do you think about that? Which color do you want? You want the? I was leaning towards the green. Do you want a different one? You want a purple? Okay. I know the green one works well. We can go with, is this purple? My wife says I'm a little colorblind, so. All right. Let's come around to YouTube. Do you want to read the scripture verse? Here, let me open my Bible too. Let's encourage them to open their Bibles, because we are a Bible-believing church, right? So it doesn't really matter what we say unless it comes from this book, right? All right, how about I let you hold this one? Let me get there. Which verse are we going to? You remember?
Revelations 2, verse 4.
Revelation 2, verse 4. All the way in the back of the Bible, the last book. I love to hear those Bible pages turning. You know, the phones, you don't see them turning, but you see them doing this. Maybe for us older people, we do this, where we enhance it and make it bigger. You probably don't do that, but I do that on my phone. I make it bigger so I can read it. All right.
Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love and you had at first.
All right. Mine says, Revelation 2:4, which is very similar to yours, nevertheless, I have this against you. This is God speaking, that you have left your first love. All right, now before we begin, I need a little help on the sermon. What would you say love is? I'm going to put you on the spot, because I know you have a vast experience in it.
Kindness.
Ooh, kindness.
Giving.
Ooh.
And probably having family, friends.
Family and friends. Ooh, I like that. Well, we've read the Bible verse. How about we pray together? How about you pray first and I'll go second? What do you think? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I want to kneel. Why don't you kneel too? Let's pray.
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you that we can be here. Thank you that most of the people are here. Please help the ones that are not here to make the right decision to come here. Thank you that we had a great children's story and our Sabbath schools are up again. And thank you for church. And thank you that we can all be here today. Amen.
Amen. Dear Lord, I know we're here, we're broken, or we're looking in need of a Savior, which is Jesus. I just pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will touch our hearts and our minds. Wake us up, Lord, in you. We want your love to be revealed in our lives. And Lord, we want not just a glimpse, we want a taste who you are. Show us, Lord, we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. You know, Addie, before you go down, I want to tell you, my favorite Sabbath last year was the one that we did together. So I'm going to plant the seed. Now we're in July. Mm-hmm. How about, we did a sermon on Enoch, right? Mm-hmm. Do you remember what it was?
Yeah.
What was it?
It was about his love for God.
His love for God. And he walked with God and he was no more. How about, so we have this small series going. How about you and I preach again in October? Okay. What do you think? You pick what we preach on, though. I pick last time, you pick. So pray about it, let God pick, but then you come back and let's do one. What do you think?
Yeah.
All right. Well, happy Sabbath to you. You want me to help you with the mic? Or?
No.
Okay. I get to. I don't want purple. She said I get to have purple. Well, welcome, church family, to your church, to Chehalis Seventh-day Adventist Church. For the few visitors, and it looks like we have a few, don't worry, we're not going to call you up front and introduce you, but I do want you to feel welcomed. I do hope you stay around and greet some people, and it's a blessing to have you here, the longtime members and also the new people. So my name is Pastor John, and I want to welcome those two online. And we are starting a sermon series on Revelation. And as soon as I said that, you thought certain people thought certain things. But I want to change your thinking on Revelation. So I hope you have your Bibles with you, because we're going to move today, and we're going to move quickly. So let's go to Revelation. Revelation chapter 1. Start right in the beginning. Revelation chapter 1. My wife is out of town still with family, but she called me this morning, and she prayed with me, which was pretty cool. Don't you love it when people pray with you and pray for you? Man, I love it. So, it's Revelation chapter 1. Now, I ask this of you today. Try to keep an open mind. I ask for you to ask for the Holy Spirit into your heart, because as we read this, there's a lot of literal things. There's symbolism. There's lots of things revealing itself. What I'm going to try to do in 30 minutes or 25 minutes really would take probably a week to go through in just chapter 1. So, let's begin. The revelation of Jesus Christ. Bam, first five words. The revealing of Jesus Christ. If you don't want to read Revelation, then you've missed it. The revealing of Jesus Christ. Isn't that what we as Christians are waiting for? The revealing of Jesus Christ. Let's slow down a little bit. Which God gave to him to show his servants things that must shortly take place. That's to us too. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, right? We believe this is John, the apostle, the one that Jesus loved, to all these things that he saw. Now, don't miss it. This is why we study Revelation. It's not a closed book. If it was a closed book, the first five words wouldn't be the revealing of Jesus Christ. That is the opening up or the coming of Jesus Christ. Verse 3, blessed is he or she who reads those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep the things which are written in it, for the time is near. This is the only book of the 66 books in the Bible that I've seen, and hopefully you can show me another one, because hopefully there's more, that says, blessed is he, and we can say she too, who reads from this book. If we're not reading from Revelation, then I think we've missed it. All 66 books are very relevant. And this one starts off with a revealing of Jesus. In verse 3, it gives us a blessing for reading it. So whatever preconceived thoughts you may have had before, maybe I had before, I tell you what, the last few weeks as I've been studying this, with any free time I've had, I've been studying it. It ties in with the sanctuary. It ties in with the sanctuary. So then it really gets deep with the symbolism. And we need to understand the sanctuary as we read Revelation. They go in together. But also as I read it, it's a love story. And ladies are like, what? What? It's a love story. Gentlemen, it's a love story. You remember when you courted your wife, right? It's not been that long ago, has it? Ladies, they were romantic, weren't they? Iris, was Paul pretty romantic? Yeah? Clyde? I shouldn't ask Clyde. Charmy, you know? Was he romantic? Yeah? Yes, it is a love story. The true beauty of this story is this. It's a love story that you have been invited to, each of you. You are being courted right now, and you have a choice whether or not to fall in love and stay in love. You will not be forced, prodded, or even manipulated. But know this, you are loved. It's a love story. So the last book, Revelation, begins with the revealing of Jesus Christ. I mean, I can't really think of a better beginning. How do you have a better beginning than the revealing of Jesus Christ? And we also know, because I know your scholars out there, Revelation ends with the literal revealing of Jesus Christ, the second coming. So it begins with the revealing, it ends with the revealing of Jesus Christ. So what's he coming for? let's read a little bit more. Let's get the answers from the Bible. John chapter, or Revelation chapter, I like John, but it starts off with John. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4. Now let's dig through this, because today I want to talk about the church of Ephesus, which is chapter 2. But we really need to get through chapter 1 if we're going to go to chapter 2, because we need to lay a foundation. Without reading chapter 1, we'll have no foundation for chapter 2. So read it with me. John to the seven churches which are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is, who was, and is to come. Past, present, and right there, the future. From the seven spirits who are before the throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the prince and ruler of the kings of this earth. Now look the next verse. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. As I was going through some Bible commentary and reading Spirit of Prophecy, I came across this. It said, when the soldier, he washed us with his blood, right? He washed us with his blood. When the soldiers pierced the side of Jesus as he hung on the cross, he's dying for our sins, there came out two distinct streams, one of blood and one of water. Remember that? Blood and water. The blood was to wash away the sins of those who should believe in his name. Remember, he's courting us. He's not forcing us. And water to represent the living water, which if obtained from Jesus, will give us life to the believer. Early writings, page 209. Jesus wants to wash us and make us new. Let's look at that again. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and made us kings and priests to his God and to Father, to be glory and dominion forever and ever. Verse 7, behold, he is coming in with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those that pierced him, and all the tribes and all the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. Verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I think it's hard for my finite mind, who was born and who someday will die if Christ hasn't come, that he's always been. How do you explain that? Right? He's always been and he always will be. Now think about this thought. Someday, Revelation, Christ is the bridegroom coming for the church, which is the bride. That's you and me. It's a wedding. It's a love story. I was in Texas last weekend. I officiated a wedding. It's a love story. I've never seen an ugly bride. It's a love story. And all the grooms at the weddings would agree with me when I said, your bride is beautiful. Oh, yes. It's a love story. Christ is the bridegroom coming for his church, which is the bride. Verse 8, I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and the end, says the Lord. Who is, here it is again, who is, who was, and who is to come. Past, present, and future. I notice when God repeats himself over and over again, we need to be paying attention. This is not past history, it is. It's not present history, it is. It's not just future history, it is. It's past, present, and future. What I mean to that, it applies to the church's not just of Asia, which we're getting to, but it applies to churches in the past, during the Pentecost time, it applies to the churches today. Let's keep going, verse 9. I, John, both your brother and companion in tribulation, brothers and sisters, we are in tribulation, right? And kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ was on an island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. So John was the last disciple alive. All the disciples had died for Christ, right? He was the last one, and they couldn't kill him. They sent him to Patmos, this island, thinking, well, he won't be able to share the gospel anymore. What can he do? So he's probably a little bit down. I spoke with a few people yesterday. Most of the conversations were pretty positive. But I spoke with a few people that were down. What do? We encourage them. We pray for them. But we also tell them that Jesus is there with them. Don't miss it. John's on an island here. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, and I heard behind me a loud voice of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha, the Omega, the first and the last. John is in vision now. And what you see, John, write in this book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia. So John is in vision, and Jesus shows up. What are the seven churches? Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. Now that's where the sanctuary now comes into place. And in the midst, I saw seven lampstands with one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his feet, girded with his chest the golden band, and his head and hair were white like wool and white as snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, and if it had been refined in a furnace, and a voice as a trumpet of many waters. Do we have a picture, Richard, of the sanctuary? Remember Moses? And built for the children of Israel, the sanctuary. You have the entrance and the altar of burnt offerings on the outer right there. Then you have the laver. Then going into the holy place, you have the table of showbread, the altar of incense, and the golden lampstand. And then next to that is the Ark of the Covenant in the most holy place. So we're going to be at the golden lampstand. And Jesus is standing there in the midst. Christ is present with his people to shed light and knowledge of him, who he is, and what his plan is for you. He wants to grow us into his likeness. Now, in the sanctuary, the candlestick is in the holy place. Was in the holy place. The book of Revelation, again, is a love story representing that Christ is there for each of the churches. Now, the seven churches, we're going to get into Ephesus today. But the churches have baggage. Anybody in a relationship now, in a marriage? There's a little baggage sometimes, right? Now, husbands don't agree too much. But there's times there's trouble. Because we're broken. But there's a little baggage. And what I want you to see is this. We have seven churches. Each church, Christ is in the midst. He's not just with the churches that are doing things right. He's also with the churches that are doing things wrong. I love that when you're in the heat of a battle, Christ is right there. I remember when I was in school, I know it's probably hard for you to believe, but at one time I had a little bit of trouble with one of my teachers. And I felt a little defeated because I'm a little guy at this time and they're pretty big and whatever they say goes, and I didn't feel like she heard me. And we want to be heard, right? And I remember coming, or my dad was coming, and when he showed up, I felt like I had someone there on my side. God is there in the midst, and he's there on our side. My wife is out of town, so maybe I can share the story. It's probably a story that I have to be very careful sharing. But when I was in college my first year, Columbia Union College up in Washington, D.C., my freshman year, I ran into a young lady that I had met in second grade in Ohio. And now we're both in Washington, D.C., and we happened to reconnect in Washington, D.C. We just happened to go to the same college. And I liked her. So since I wanted to get to know her more, I spent time with her. I invited her to church events. I asked her to dinner, lunch, breakfast. When she got out of class, I would walk her to her next class. or walk her to the dorm, invite her to come to church with me and sit next to me, and we sat up there where the heathen sit. Sorry up there, I know you're still listening. I sat up there with her, but I did that to get to know her. And we spent time together. We talked, we shared, we even prayed together to get to know her. Christ is in the midst of these churches because he hasn't given up on us. Each church is applicable today because it relates to where we're at. Well, how does it relate? We're in 2021. Our church has baggage. In many ways, as we review these seven churches over the next couple months, you will see that we have fallen to many of the same problems they have. Hopefully, too, though, we've had some of the same victories that they have. And what I also like, that each church, God gives them encouragement at the end. And it's one thing to make a mistake, but isn't it beautiful when, at the very end, if you come out right, God says you can eat from the tree of life. Let's go to Genesis. Let's go to Genesis. Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, God created. I'm going to skim through this. God created, divided light from darkness on the first day. Then God said, "It is good." Separated the waters, divided the waters, day two. In the evening and morning, the second day, God said, "It is good." Day three, God said, "It is good." Day four, God said, "It is good," after his creation. Day five, God said, "It is good." Day one was night and day. Two was sky and sea. Three was land and vegetation. Four was sun, moon, and stars. Day five was sea creatures and fish and birds. Day six, God makes animal and man and says it is very good. Everything God made was perfect. Day seven came. Verse 31 of chapter 1, then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. And what's God do? Chapter 2, thus the heavens and the earth and all hosts of them were finished, complete. Verse 2 of 2, in the seventh day God ended his work from which he had done. God rested on that seventh day of all his work, what he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day. God blessed it, God sanctified it, God rested from the work that he had done. It was made perfect. In the vision, as we read in Revelation, God showed himself on his holy day. As John was going through tribulation, Jesus showed up to encourage him, to court him, to lead him. And he showed up among the candlesticks. Well, what are the candlesticks? So let's keep reading. Let's go back to Revelation. I want you to realize, though, in the beginning of creation, what God made was perfect. Revelation, God is wanting again to bring back perfection. Right? It was perfect. Eve sinned. She chose to sin. Right? Her choice. She was deceived. But she walked away. She walked out of the relationship. She was made perfect. Adam was made perfect. They walked away. They ate from the one tree they were told not to eat from, the one tree they were told not to go over to, and they ate from it and made the decision to walk away. When we look to self, our eyes go off Jesus and we sin. They chose the separation. Now, the beauty of Revelation is you have all the books in between, and God's trying to make it right again, whole again. He's coming, the bridegroom, for his bride, the church. Let's go back to Revelation. We need to finish. We need to finish one so we can get to the church. Verse 16 of chapter 1. in his right hand 7 stars out of his mouth with a sharp 2-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. Can you imagine seeing that? Son of man clothed with a garment down to his feet, girded about his chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were like a flame. His feet were like fine brass and refined furnace. His voice is the sound of many waters. In his right hand, the 7 stars. Out of his mouth was a 2-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in strength. So let's look out of his mouth came the 2-edged sword. Put your bulletin in there so you can keep your spot. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. You can really compare the vision the same with Daniel's vision in Daniel chapter 10. There was a lot of similarities. But his right hand, 7 stars, and out of his mouth was a 2-edged sword. Now look at this, verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any 2-edged sword. Why do we pass out Bibles today? We're teaching young people to read God's word, God's living word, and it's sharper than a 2-edged sword. What does that mean? Let's keep going. Sharper than a 2-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and spirit, and the joints and the marrow, and discerner of our thoughts and intents of our hearts. God uses this to change us. By beholding, we say we become changed. If we're not opening God's Bible, we're not learning about Jesus. We need to talk with Jesus. I can do it through prayer and by reading God's word. Sharper than a 2-edged sword. Going back now to Revelation. Verse 16, and in his right hand, the 7 stars. I've started a study on the right hand. And if you know me at all, you know that I often mention the right hand. It's always the right. When Christ ascended, he's seated on the right-hand side of the Father. When Stephen was stoned and he looked up to heaven, Jesus was seated on the right hand. When the disciples were fishing and caught nothing, he said, throw the nets on the right side. On the thieves on the cross, one accepted Jesus and one didn't. We have a right and we have a left. Always on the right is power, is glory. It's where Jesus is. So I'm looking up all these verses. I have over 50 verses with the right hand, the blessing, the power, the right hand. God says, I will hold you with my righteous right hand. I mean, there's so much symbolism to all this. And then what does he say? Verse 17, and when I saw this, John, he fell as a dead man, and he lay. So get this, I'm going too fast. John fell down like a dead man. If I saw all that too, I think I'd be face down on the floor. What did God do? But Jesus laid his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. In our baggage and tribulation, God is there. When he shows himself to us by reading his word and praying, he's there. When we're overcome by what we see in the world we live in, he is there. And he reaches out with his right hand, saying, do not be afraid. I am the first. I am the last. I am who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. At Christ's crucifixion, the last nail was nailed in the devil's coffin. When Christ followed through and died on the cross, that was it. He won the victory. Now the devil's only hope is to take as many with him as he can. Christ has won. The battle's been won. At times, I know in this world, we feel like we've been overcome, and it's like the devil feels like at times he is winning. He may win some small battles in your life, in my life, but God is right there laying his righteous right hand on us, saying, I have overcome. I was once dead, now I'm alive, and I am alive forevermore. Amen. So be it. And I hold the keys to Hades and death. Write these things that you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place. Now here, it starts describing now the mystery of verse 20 of chapter 1, the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. These are all relevant today because we too struggle with the same things each of these churches struggle with. Let's read on the loveless church now, the angel of the loveless church, chapter 2. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says, he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. God is speaking, I know your works, I know your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. You have tested those things, and them who say they are apostles and are not. You have found them liars. You have preserved. You have patience. You have labored in my name's sake and have not become weary. If God said that about me or you, wouldn't you be like, yes, that's awesome. Great. Look what I've done. Oh. Verse 4 that Addie read so well. Nevertheless, John, I have this against you. Put your name in there. That you have left your first love. They did all these things right, and yet they left their first love. I do believe the Adventist Church is doctrinally sound. But if all becomes about what you've done instead of what he's done for you, then you've missed it. You've fallen out of love. However, if you've gone to the other side and go, well, it's nothing more. I've accepted Jesus. Now I'm done. I just keep living in the world. I don't need to share Jesus with anybody else. I'm good. I've accepted him. I've been baptized. You've missed it. I was reading, man, this really hit me hard. I was reading, but after a time, the zeal of believers, their love for God and for one another began to wane. Coldness crept into the church. They went from being on fire for God, inviting people to know about God, to having their candlestick lit in love for God, letting their light shine for God, to their lack of interest in the salvation of souls showed that they had lost their first love. Why? Because of their lack of interest in the salvation of souls showed that they had lost their first love. For none can love God with their whole heart, mind, and soul, and strength without loving those from whom Christ died for. Wow, that really hit me hard. Adam and Eve, I took you back to the Garden of Eden because they walked away from their first love, which was God. From the Garden of Eden, God has had a plan in place. Redemption, right? The cross, been placed, but to bring us back as his bride, his church, to make us new again. Lucifer, which means light bearer, he was one of the angels closest to God, who's now Satan. His name means light bearer, and his love for God diminished. It went out. It went about what he thought, what he wanted to do, how we should do it, how church should happen, who should be worshipped, who shouldn't be worshipped, how things should go. The light bearer went out. So what does he do in the Garden of Eden? He tells Eve, surely you will not die if you eat this fruit, but you will become like God himself. The first temptation of sin is being self-righteous, that I can be like God. Brothers and sisters, we want to emulate God, but we do not want to take God's place. There's a difference. We want to behold him and emulate him and follow his actions, be like Jesus, but we don't want to take his place. The churches, think of in Matthew 25. Do you remember the 10 virgins in Matthew 25? 10 virgins waiting for the bridegroom to come. They each had their lamp, right? We're talking about the candlestick. They each had their lamp with the little flames going, waiting for the bridegroom to come. They all fell asleep, but five had enough oil. Yes, the oil represents the Holy Spirit, but the oil also represents their love for God. This church, Ephesus, says, "Nevertheless, I have this against you. You have left your first love." Eve left Adam's side, sinned. Adam left God's side, fallen Eve, and sinned. Lucifer left God's side and sinned. God is trying to reconcile us back together. You know, we're broken. God wants to make us whole. Some of us have broken hearts, broken marriages, broken relationships. We're broken. Satan wants to quench our candlestick and put out our love for him. Remove that fire. Let's keep reading. Chapter 2, verse 5. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do your first work. I think that's pretty simplistic. We don't have to make it overly difficult today. Repent. I'm sorry. How many times do we hear we even say, "Well, I'm not going to say sorry until they say sorry." Well, it's not my fault. They should say sorry to me. Repent. Repent. And do your first works. Husbands, when you were dating your wives, remember, you brought them flowers, you took them chocolates, you maybe went to the Space Needle, you courted them, you loved them, you spent time with them. You wanted them to know them personally. But why do we keep falling out of love? It says, repent and go back to your first works. I mean, really, if you look at this church, they've done all these things right, except they fell out of love. So it became more about what they were doing instead of what Christ had done for them. And I don't like this, or else. I remember my parents would say, do this or else. But here's this or else. We need to be straight here. We're not going to sugarcoat the gospel. Or else, I will come quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Brothers and sisters, God is right there, but he's not going to force you. He's going to love you all the way to the death on the cross, but he's not going to force you. Verse 6, but this you have. Now he's given another compliment, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I have also hated. They had sold their souls for the love of food that was blessed by idols or given to idols, for adultery, for abominations, for what they thought was right, walking away from God, as it said, following Balaam. Balaam was supposed to be a prophet for God. Verse 7, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him or her that overcomes, don't miss this, I will give to eat from the tree of life. God's bringing us back. He's reconciling us back. In the beginning, the tree of life was there. They could eat freely from it. He's bringing us back to the tree of life. He wants us to eat again from that tree of life, which is in the midst of the garden. I I remember as I was finishing my freshman year, it had been a full year and it had been a good year, the young lady and I really grew close. And I remember one evening as school was ending, she looked at me and she said, "Well, I think we should get married. What do you think?" I did love her. I told her I loved her. But apparently I didn't remember the verse there in 1 John 4:18 that love casts out all fear. I mean, I was a freshman in college. You know, how do I support her? How do I move on? I wasn't ready. So like any probably young man would do, I ran for my life. The next year I went to school down in Tennessee. I didn't know that it was the matrimonial school there at Southern. But then I stopped spending time with her. We grew cold. And I fell out of love. Yes, God had other plans. I have no regrets for who I married. Today, though, I want you to come in that relationship with Jesus and marry the bridegroom. So I'm going to repeat the marriage vows. I did this week. I'm going to do this for Pastor Enrique's wedding in August. I'm going to do it for another wedding in September. And put your name in here. Repeat after me. Now you say your name. John, take thee, Jesus Christ, to be my lawfully wedded bridegroom. And I do promise before God and these witnesses, these are vows now, to be thy loving and faithful church. In plenty and in want. I sure do like the plenty, the want's a challenge. In joy and in sorrow. And in health. As long as we both shall live. That's forever. God wants us to make that vow today, tomorrow, and the next. As we examine these churches, I mean, I'm just going to be straight with you. You're not going to understand them unless you read ahead and start reading and asking God into your life. The responsibility is not mine, but all of ours to know Jesus. And he wants to know you personally. And you each have the gifts that he wants. But he wants to grow you more. There's nothing you've done that he can't forgive if you repent. He has given it all to be with you. Now the question is, will you give it all to be with him? I like this verse found from the thoughts from the Mount of Blessings. True repentance is turning self to Christ. At Christ's second coming, the church will be united with the bridegroom and the official wedding ceremony will take place forever. I pray that we will not be outside that celebration, but that we will be inside in that celebration. Won't you come today, repent, and let's eat together from the tree of life. Let's pray. Dear Lord, you are revealing yourself to us. We have so much going on around us, Lord, that takes our attention from you. But Lord, you've shown us the basics. You've asked to know us. You've died for us. You've given all heaven for us. Lord, what is blocking our view of you? I do want to be like Ephesus. They did so many good things other than the point of falling out of love for you. Lord, I just pray for the church family today. Only you can change our hearts. Only you can change my heart. Lord, I want to be created new today, tomorrow, and the next. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and end. Lord, thank you for being there and laying your righteous right hand upon us, standing us up. But now, Lord, may we go forward and share your love with others, your testimony, your gifts, your joys. And may we all, as Addie said, be part of your family. I ask in Jesus' precious and saving name. And all God's people say, amen.